Welcome, first-time listeners and returners, to the Sports Deli, where thoughtful conversations and insightful guests are always tops on the menu. Now grab your favorite bagel or deli sandwich and favorite beverage, and let's do this together in the Sports Deli. Tonight's podcast is sponsored by SportRx. Sport, the letter R, the letter X, SportRx.com, the leader in sports prescription eyewear. You can find them online at SportRx.com. Make sure when you check out, you put in the code DELI10, that's DELI10. Again, we're joined by Doug Williams, number 17, baby, right here. He was a baseball pitcher growing up, in addition to playing football, and why his legendary Hall of Fame college coach, Eddie Robinson, thinks in part contributed to him having such a rare, strong, and accurate arm as a quarterback. The day before the Super Bowl that he won over John Elway and the Denver Broncos, he had a six-hour root canal. Grambling State honored Williams by naming a street in his honor on the college's campus. He's a member of the College Football Hall of Fame, and as Wendell mentioned earlier, the first African-American quarterback to win a Super Bowl and be named Super Bowl MVP. He's currently the Senior Vice President of Player Development for the Washington Football Team. Doug, again, it's truly an honor. We've had a lot of guests on, but this is definitely the highlight of this show so far, and thanks for joining us in the Sports Deli. Time out. We don't know why you're taking time out to join us on our show, but we're truly honored. You're a legend. You don't get enough credit.
Come on, Coach.
How are you, Coach? You have two diehard Washington football fans lifelong and one Lions fan, and by the series of the questions, you'll be able to tell who's who.
Good.
Honestly, since you were the starting quarterback, it's been 32 years, and you may or may not realize it. There has been 32 starting quarterbacks in Washington since. That's obviously an average of one a year. The team's going in the right direction, but what is it going to take to solidify the starting quarterback position long term with the team?
Well, you know, let's be fair to the team too. You know, you can pick a lot of quarterbacks, but sometimes the puzzle might not fit.
Right.
You know, you got to hit on the guy. And I think when you hit, you get lucky. And that don't happen every day.
You never aspire to want to be a coach in the NFL? I know you coached at Grambling. And did you ever think about the possibility of eventually becoming a head coach in the NFL?
You know what? I had one opportunity to coach in the NFL, and for no reason, I don't know why, John Gruden, when he was the offensive coordinator in Philadelphia, he did call me and offer me an opportunity to come in and coach his quarterbacks. And I think what had happened then mentally for me, having played the league and had to overcome so many things, had to go through so many stigma. Yeah, I probably was kind of pissed with the league at that time and didn't want to get back in it. But as I look back, you know, that might be one decision I made that probably wasn't a good one. I had a chance to go with Jim Caldwell over in at Wake Forest, and I didn't do that. But sometimes you make those decisions, you got to live with them.
Doug, I want to ask you, I want to make sure I frame this correctly, because it can't be overstated enough what you overcame growing up and where you're from, you know, not far from Baton Rouge, but so you've done a lot of interviews. You have a movie being made about you. You're from the South, obviously. They're from D.C. I'm from Detroit, unfortunately, and from a Lions perspective, of course. So, you know, what we've learned about you, which is fascinating to me, is that you've always taken the high road. You've always had this inner resiliency, this strength about you, where you've had to overcome unthinkable social, educational, and athletic challenges. But you've always seemed to follow your inner compass, even when it seemed insurmountable. And you always remain steadfast to your convictions and goals. You know, what influences or life moments help mold you so that, you know, you made the right decisions? And because a lot of people don't go down the right path, and you did. And what do you attribute it to?
Well, I think my upbringing, I think I was fortunate. You know, my mom used to always preach to us about, you know, don't put yourself up too high because you wouldn't have that for the fall, and you treat people the same. My dad was one of them steadfast. When he said something, he meant it. And, you know right from wrong. Had an older brother, was the same way. And, you know, we was all competitive. It was eight of us in the family, and all of us was competitive, athletic. So you learn how to get that discipline and hard work and deal with it that from that standpoint. And going to high school, I was fortunate enough to have coaches that had played in college, like at Grambling. Two of my coaches that went to Grambling, one that played baseball at Southern University, and they was able to bring us up. And this is before integration. You know, they didn't integrate in my hometown until 1970. I was in the ninth grade when that happened. Right. So basically, all my coaches was black men who always wanted us to go on the right path. And then fortunate enough to go to Grambling and play for Eddie Robinson. And taught you that it wasn't about the X's and O's. Life is about Joe. And it's about not on the field, but off the field. How you handle yourself on the field. And I always learned that no matter what happened, it was water under the bridge. Some things you can't change. You only change. You only deal with the things that you can. And that you can't, you put in the rearview mirror and you go forward. Well, let me say this, and you might not understand this, but I played in the SWAC, the SWAC Conference. Mm-hmm. And I can tell you this, probably from if you go from probably 1974 on back, anybody in the SWAC probably could have competed with anybody else in the SEC because right. Why? That's where all of them were going to school. They couldn't do that about the LSU and all the schools back then.
Right.
You know, I played against Walter Payton and Robert Bazile and Jackie Slater as a freshman. Right. They were all on the same team at Jackson State. So that let you know where the talent was back then. It was at the historical black colleges because they were not able to go to the schools in the South at that particular time.
Doug, you bring up Jackson State, and obviously we have all heard Deion Sanders getting the coaching job there. I'm just curious, A, what was your first reaction when you heard that, and how do you think that could potentially change recruiting, maybe not for the LSU and the Alabamas, but the mid-majors, the guy, the kid looking at, let's say, a Tulane or an East Carolina, and could that elevate the HBCUs on the Division I level?
Well, you know, I'm sure it was in the works at the time, but before Deion took the job, him and I talked probably about a month before he got the job. I knew he was going to get the job a month out, him and I talked, because he was trying to talk about what's the landmine in historical black institutions.
Right.
So we talked about that, but I think it's a great, great opportunity for black colleges, the SWAC conference, and for Deion. I think he's going to bring a lot to the institution. I think I'm bringing a lot to the conference. I think I'm bringing a lot of visibility to the whole country to realize that you don't have to go to Power Five to play. I do think you're going to do a tremendous job of whether or not guys transfer there or go there from high school, what have you. So Deion is a plus for Jackson State and the Southwestern Athletic Conference.
You know, your son, you have eight kids, you're an amazing dad, you know, you're married, and like you said, you have a 12 and a 14-year-old, and after the George Floyd death, your son, who works for Sean Payton with New Orleans under Vince Lombardi's grandson, Joe Lombardi, you know, he sent you a text after the death, and he said, and I quote, "You raised a strong black man, you created America's worst nightmare, a smart, educated, ambitious black man with great character. Thanks for that, Pops." And then, you know, he went on to say how he can't even imagine what you had to go through, and that he loves you. What did that mean to you? I mean, that whole time of period in the summer, but your son sending that to you, because you don't really know how people feel until, you know, something like that maybe happens.
You really don't, you know, but here's a young man that, you know, got the fortitude to tell his daddy how he felt about it. And I always wondered, always worried about him when he was driving back and forth from Zachary, Louisiana to Grambling, had to go through Mississippi at night and all. You know, I always worried about him on the road. Him and I used to talk all the time. And I used to tell him all the time, man, if they stop you, just be as nice and graceful as you can. And I can honestly say, you know, that he's a kid that if he wasn't my kid, I would want him to be my kid. For him to send me that text, you know, send chills, and I got a little emotional about it, you know, because sometimes you never really know how your kids really feel about you. But when you can get one like that, it stands out.
You know, Doug, and I have to agree the fact that how proud you must feel, because, you know, your son's generation, your children's generations, they're going to be the one that's going to move this society forward. You know, my podcast, I always say for people our age, past that, we're too ingrained for the most part. So that will change, but for the most part, we're too ingrained in terms of our thinkings, our thoughts, and our feelings. Over 70 million people voting for the other guy showed that. So, you know, what gives me hope for when we get a little bit older and the younger folks take care of start to take care of us in this country is, you know, people your son's age, you know, having those strong foundations of unity, love, togetherness, and such.
Well, you know, I mean, doing this whole after George Floyd, man, it's for me, you know, I was old enough to know about the first part of the civil rights back in 65 in that era. I'm old enough to know that. And to see what transpired this summer and to see so many people go out and protest, not just black folks. You know, early on back the first civil rights, there was a lot of black people walking with a few white that they were putting dogs and shooting the water hose on. But to see so many diverse young people out this time, to me, I think was the turning point. And I felt pretty good about that. But, you know, my 12-year-old girl, probably the only one that sat on the sofa with me and watched the news, watched CNN, and she asked me one day, she said, "Dad, why are you always watching CNN?" And I told her, just like you just said, it's not for me, it's for you. You know, I want to make sure that what's going on, I can tell them what's happening. So I want them to do the right thing. And I'm just glad that hopefully America could see what's really going on and get this ship on the right direction. And really,
Doug, as you probably saw, the Cleveland Indians are pretty much going to announce this week they're changing their name. What would you recommend in the process of, I think the Washington football team has done a good job this year. I think, you know, considering 1 year in the history of the old name, what would you recommend the process that they go through and how to get the community in Cleveland engaged in understanding and embracing it and then moving forward from there? And a follow-up on the 87 team, one of the things that was unique about that team, it was played in a strike season. And about a year or two ago, you honored players on that team and gave them Super Bowl rings, and you were part of that. There was an ESPN documentary about that, and I don't know what impetus that was, but did you appreciate until you saw those former players how important that those rings were to them? And being recognized was to them after all those years?
Doug, it's really interesting because you talked about the 87 Super Bowl, the championship, and I guess you could say that you're a bridge from one generation of me and Wax and others who grew up in that area who knew the Washington football team, how important it was to the city, that term, that nickname that we used is so hard in terms of us letting it go because of the memories that it had. But you're a bridge now of trying to introduce a new generation of football fans to the Washington, D.C. metropolitan area, not as the nickname that it was before and everything that it symbolized, the championships, the winning Joe Gibbs and all that such, those type of things. But now the Washington football team and building a foundation for when they become our age, that they can tell their kids about this Washington football team and the in the history that you're starting with right now.
You are listening to an interview with former Super Bowl quarterback for the Washington football team, Doug Williams, who's currently the senior vice president of player development for that same Washington football team. At the conclusion of Super Bowl 42, on the 20th anniversary of being named Super Bowl 22 MVP, Williams himself carried the Vince Lombardi trophy onto the field for the presentation to the winning New York Giants. And now back to this unbelievably historic, incredible interview with Doug Williams in the Sports Deli. Doug, I want to ask you, you talked about Dan Snyder, and you know, there's, you know, been a lot of things over the years, and when we looked at the wobble and the bubble and how LeBron, you know, and a lot of the leagues during the summertime, you know, took to the Black Lives Matter movement and Breonna Taylor and all that. And, you know, you've gone on record as saying Dan Snyder has done a lot of things to support this movement, maybe not publicly because he's not a Jerry Jones. He's a behind the scenes kind of guy. And so maybe share with everybody what you've seen from Dan Snyder that nobody would ever know because you're behind the scenes, and what he's done and how you feel the NFL has handled, you know, this whole systemic racism and Black Lives Matter movement.
Well, I think Dan, and I say this, I think he's an introvert, but Dan has already committed to whatever we need to do. And with Ron, is the one that told, you know, Dan from the start, when it first happened, Dan just, you know, threw out $250,000 to get it started, to seed money to do whatever we need to do for to make sure we support racial injustice in this country and in this area. I think that's the key. But Dan is not a guy that won't be known as a guy that say, you know, Dan Snyder did this or Dan Snyder did that. But I can only say since I've been here, and especially this year, I've seen him commit to a lot more things than he probably ever has.
That's awesome. You know, I've been on the show somewhat critical of, you know, some of the owners. I know the Cleveland Browns owners have been, you know, sort of at the forefront of speaking out on the issue. And like you said, some people, everybody handles it differently. But I just wish there was a more collective front by the white people in the league, especially, that have the money, the Tom Brady's, you know, the Jerry Jones, because it's really frustrating to me because I think it's a white problem in large part. White people run this country. And I just wish more in all the professional leagues, the white people that run the leagues from the owners to the players. I've been critical of Tom Brady. I love him, but it's just really frustrating. So I don't know how you feel about that or, you know, but that's how I feel.
Well, I do. I'm not going to sit here and shoot cold either. You know, it's not a black, it's not just a black thing. You know, we can say Black Lives Matter and we hear people say Blue Lives Matter. It's not about that. We talk about all the young black men, black women who've been killed over the years with nothing being done. You know, until white folks stand up with the black folks. And then you hit on a couple guys, you know, I was disappointed with how Favre stood up and the guy that Jay Cutler, you know, even if you don't say anything, you just send a message out to the guys that you was in the dressing room with, that you was in the huddle with, that tell y'all didn't matter to me. I made my money. I didn't give a damn about you. So whatever, this is my feeling. I think somewhere along the line, Aaron Rodgers might be one of the only guys I know that stood up. You know, and you appreciate guys when they stand up. You know, the white guys, let me tell you something, and they don't understand this, but their black teammates give them more respect when they stand up for a cause like that than they would ever get in their whole life. Because they understand that, you know, they got a lot of pressure on them, and I'm sure they've been in circles that some of their buddies might have said something outrageous that they've heard and, you know, didn't say anything about it. And if they stand up and say something, they don't know how their buddy might react. But if you stand up and say something, you show the heart and the fortitude to say what's right and what's wrong.
And it's not even as hard as it – excuse me, Wendell, 1 second. It's not even as hard as it was when Colin did what he did. Like, it's not even difficult now to stand up as a white or even African-American athlete in the locker room. Like, everyone already laid the foundation for you. Like, just say Black Lives Matter. Like, why is that so freaking difficult? It's so frustrating that they will not do it. Well, we do what we do behind closed doors. And, man, get out of here with that. Like, say it. Like, say it. Just say it. You know, it's not hard. I guess it is hard.
Mike, let me tell you this, Michael. You know, we're not trying to take anything away from anybody. We just want the same opportunity that anybody else gets. You people always talk to me about the Super Bowl. You know what? I was afforded an opportunity. Joe Gibbs gave me an opportunity. If Joe Gibbs don't give me the opportunity, I don't play the Super Bowl. That's what life is all about. It's about opportunity.
Yeah. I think it comes down also between the difference between racism and privilege. And I think a lot of white folks don't know the difference between racism and privilege and how it's used, because they'll say, well, you know, I'm not burning anybody's, you know, I'm not calling anybody the N-word. I'm not, you know, I think that stuff is wrong. I don't have a hood over my face. I'm not burning crosses in front of anybody's yard. What are y'all talking about? But it's the way that they use their privilege, not so much to keep us down, but not to understand the things that we're going through. I see white folks all the time losing their mind, and black folks too. I'm not trying to, you know, talk about which one group, but I see white folks all the time losing their mind about having to wear a mask and when they go outside or when they go into a place, to a store. I'm thinking to myself, could y'all imagine what we have to go through? Could you imagine y'all had to go through that every single day for the rest of your lives, every day of your life? So it's just a matter, I think, of trying to educate, not I mentioned before, not my generation, not your generation, not the generation before, because again, the being ingrained, but the younger generation to realize the fact that, you know, your daughter is the only Black person in that school, this, that, and the other, that is a big deal. So if she says, you know, I feel a little bit uncomfortable because I'm the only person in this school that looks like me, the white folks don't look at her sideways saying, well, what's the big deal? So what if you're the only Black person in here, this, that, and the other? Right. They have to understand why she feels that way without them feeling that she's racist or something like that. You know what I mean?
I'm 65 years old, man. And the state that I wasn't happy over the last couple of weeks or so, it's not because of who won. Well, it is because of who won. But hopefully that, you know, that we can settle this country down, man, because I don't know why we don't want to give voter suppression. So why can't we just say, hey, give everybody an opportunity to vote? Oh, man, don't get me started.
Respect everybody's vote. Right. We can all vote, but respect everybody's vote.
Yeah, it's been a little emotional for me the last couple of weeks, man, because you sit there and you can't do anything about it, and you see people that are in powerful positions that don't do jack. You see people in food lines. You see people can't pay rent. And all these guys that's up here in D.C., they don't have a wonderful Christmas. Yeah. You know, they don't have a tree, their kids, their grandkids, all of them don't have a ball. You know, how hard is it, with the biggest tax cut that ever been given to a bunch of folks that are rich, how hard is it to make sure that people got food on their table, can pay their rent, to make their kids' Christmas a Christmas, man? That bothers me.
That hopefully we can have these conversations with, and that's why John and I and Gordon, when he was with us, just listen to stories like yours and the frustration and the anger and the disbelief still, and you're shaking your head, you know, that it could still possibly be going on in 2020. But like you said, you know, we have to go back to the hope that we felt during the diverse protests that you've talked about, and the fact that there are more white people standing up, and hopefully that just continues to be contagious, and that leads to policy changes and helping our homeless, you know, and helping get internet in the inner cities where African American and, you know, communities still don't have freaking internet, so the kids can't do their homework. It's just ridiculous. So we, like you said, we could talk about this for a while. I want to pivot a little bit because we're going to have Jennifer King, one of your assistant running back coaches, on the show. And you talked earlier about women, and African-American women have had it probably harder in a lot of ways than African-American men. And so talk about what an amazing person she is, and how it's been to have her in the organization, you know, as a woman in the NFL. It's just an amazing story.
Yeah, you know what, it's groundbreaking, and she have learned a lot. And I'm sure somewhere along the line, eventually Jennifer's going to have her own position. You know, I think take our hat off to Ron for giving her that opportunity, but also to her for working her behind off and not looking at it that I'm a woman doing this. You know, I'm a woman doing a man's job. She look at it as I'm a coach on the Washington football team. And I think that's the most important thing.
You know, you talked about Joe Gibbs giving you an opportunity. Many people don't realize he was your coordinator coach in Tampa Bay in 78. Mm-hmm. And one of the players I follow that I'm of that age. And I remember that, you know, that NFC championship game against the Rams in that horrible weather. You know, I think if you guys had better weather, I think a different outcome personally, you know, tight ends are such a big part of today's game. And I think you had one of the most underrated tight ends in the history of the NFL. Everybody from that generation talks about, you know, Kellen Winslow, but talk about Jimmy Giles from Alcorn State, and talk about what Jimmy Giles would be like today. Oh, and how, and talk about how, and I think if you had stayed with the Buccaneers and with him there, that probably hindered his career as much as it did you, you know, with the change of quarterbacks, because you had something going and it was cutting edge in regards that quarterbacks, tight ends weren't what they are now. And the younger people may not understand it, but Jimmy Giles, I think, just gets overlooked.
And I'm glad you said that. Somebody recognized Jimmy Giles, man. I just talked to him the other day, and I can say this. I was fortunate to have a guy who was 6'3.5", 250 pounds, run like a deer, can catch, can get you to the edge. Jimmy Giles can block. He can run. You name it. There's not a tight end today. They ain't a tight end yesterday that it was any better than Jimmy Giles. But if Jimmy had played in Joe Gibbs' offense.
Oh, right.
Jimmy Giles would be in the Hall of Fame today.
With all due respect, you guys made Clint Didier look good. I mean, I love Clint. You know what I'm saying? We're not, you know, I mean, look at the Doc Walker. Love Doc Walker, but no Jimmy Giles. Clint Didier, you know, you can go on. And, you know, basically he was a big size receiver who could block. And that was kind of, and people didn't understand that back then.
You do it all. You could play Jimmy one-on-one with a safety. You forget about a linebacker.
Oh, forget it. No.
He was strong. He was he was strong, agile, and mobile. I mean, Jimmy can do it all, man. And it's unfortunate that he didn't have 900 catches. Because they didn't throw it to him 900 times. If they had it would have been a shoe-in.
Right.
Agreed. Well, that was the owner's fault for not wanting to pay you. But that's all right. That was Washington's good fortune. All right. Well, before we leave the stage for you, we got the rapid fire here, our famous segment of the podcast, the this or that. You ready?
Yes, sir.
All right. Here we go. So you were in second grade, and your teacher was crying when JFK was shot. Do you remember where you were when MLK was shot? What was harder for you, that or when MLK was shot? Now, this is a pronunciation. Which pronunciation do you prefer? Advertisement or advertisement? All right. Cement or cement? Bullwinkle, Mr. Magoo, Flintstones, or Deputy Dog?
Oh, man.
All right. Food in Zachary, Louisiana, D.C., or Tampa Bay, Florida?
If you answer that question wrong, you can't go home. I mean,
I'm sitting in here and I smell the red beans my wife cooked today.
I hear you.
That's outstanding. Okay, do you say that you want soda, pop, or soda pop? Brady or Montana?
Brady, because everything he does is fundamentally sound. You watch him play, his feet is always planted where he's going, and his motion is always the same.
Yeah. Yep. Best pocket passer ever. Well, I know how you're going to answer this based on what you said earlier. Favre or Manning? Jim Brown or Sweetness?
Wow, Jesus. Boy, I got to go with Sweetness because I played against him as a freshman.
There you go.
And you know, his last football game was against me in the playoff in 1987.
Yep, that's right.
That's right.
Yep.
All right, Sweetness or Barry Sanders? Vacuuming, you've been married a long time. Vacuuming or dishes?
Oh man.
Sanford and Son or Good Times?
Big yep.
Elizabeth, come on. That's the big one.
I go with Sanford,
man. All right. French toast, pancakes, or waffles? What's your second choice? John, you're out of luck today, buddy.
No, well, first of all, I'm curious on the French toast, do you use challah or do you use regular bread?
It's regular light bread. We call it light bread, man.
Okay, you got to go to the store and ask them for some hollow. You get the thick. Oh, it will change your life.
It'll change it.
Just crack the eggs and put them in a bowl and just soak that toast and just put it in the skillet, man.
Let's go with hot dogs or hamburgers. Candy or popcorn at the movies. Candy. Elway or Roethlisberger. Is Philip Rivers a Hall of Famer?
Yeah.
God dang it. Russell Wilson or Aaron Rodgers?
Wow. Houdini or Aaron, huh?
Daryl Green or Ronnie Lott? Art Monk or Randy Moss?
Jesus, yeah.
That's testing you.
He got it. Jesus, who wouldn't want to throw to Randy, but I got
Sonny Jurgensen, Joe Theismann, or Sammy Baugh? All right, a couple more. What's Happening or the Jeffersons? Richard Pryor or Eddie Murphy? Die Hard or 48 Hours? Wow. That's surprising. Dave Chappelle, Kevin Hart, or Chris Rock? Willie Mays or Hank Aaron? All right. Hank or Jackie? Yeah. Barry Bonds or Pete Rose? LeBron or Jordan? There you go. All right. Two more. Belichick or Bill Walsh? All right. So you have an opening on the Washington football team as an assistant to the senior vice president of player development. Are you hiring John Wendell or me?
I'm going to step down. I'm going to have both of you all.
Remember, Doug, we talked about equality and all that kind of stuff.
You're going to put me on the spot.
Because then you hire those two because they're Jewish. You know, we got to kind of like diversify next level stuff.
Oh, why?
All right, Doug, man, it has been fun. Anything that you want to share with the world? We've been in 13 countries. You know, we've talked a lot about a lot of things on our show, but like I said, it's on behalf of all of us. It's truly been an honor. I can't thank you enough for sharing space with us and for your convictions, for being such an amazing dad, a coach when you were at Grambling, and for passing on the lessons that you learned from the Hall of Fame coach, Eddie Robinson. And, you know, people that cross paths with you, they're lucky, including us.
Well, you know what? I just want to say thank you all, first, for having me on. And, certainly appreciate that. And I just hope, you know, some of the things that I've said might resonate with a lot of people who might not think like we all do on this show. And I think everybody got their own opinion. And you're not, I don't have anything against your own opinion. But I think we need to all sit down and just look at the real life, the real situation, and say what's right and what's wrong. And if we all just do right, we have a better country. And if we have us do just right, we have a better company.
Yeah,
okay. So I think that's the most important thing, man, and realize that the man next to you, no matter what color he is just as much man as you are.
Yeah.
As a football fan of the D.C. area and watching you growing up, and you were a great quarterback, and what's even more exciting is that you're a better person. And as much as as an iconic quarterback you are, you're even a better person, and you keep it going. And I want to thank you for that.
Thank you.
And good luck down the stretch. Good luck against Seattle next week. And much love, mad respect, and keep doing what you're doing, man. You're an inspiration.
All right. Thank you all.
Thanks, man.
How do you feel about being on the Sports Deli, Wendell? Oh. Wendell, are you going to take any phone-in calls?
I better learn how to. Oh, man.
Wendell, you realize your boy Wax just went in on you. All right, later, boys. Great job, Wendell.
All right, man.
I enjoyed it, man.
All right. Sounds good. Thanks, man. Appreciate it.
Yeah, you got it, brother. Right. Much love.
Later,
Wax. Thank you again for joining us in the Sports Deli. Special thanks to Doug Williams, the first African-American quarterback in the history of the NFL to win a Super Bowl and win a Super Bowl MVP. He threw 4 touchdown passes all in the second quarter, a record for a Super Bowl. And again, until next time, please mask up. Black Lives Matter. Peace.